I seriously doubt that Professor de Sautoy needs a lot of introduction. I will say a few things about him, though. So if anybody in this audience does not know who he is, they will certainly know now. Professor de Sautoy is a professor of mathematics at the University of Oxford and a fellow of Wedham College. He has been named by the Independent Sunday, which is a newspaper in the UK, as one of the UK's leading scientists. He won the prestigious Birkwick Prize of the London Mathematical Society, awarded every 2 years to reward the best mathematical research made by a mathematician under 40. He is really a well-known scientist, very distinguished one with a lot of academic books and articles, and also a great popularizer of science. He has been a visiting professor at the École Normale et Supérieure in Paris, the Max Planck Institute in Bonn, and the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and also the Australian National University in Canberra. As I said, he is a world-renowned popularizer of mathematics. A lot of you have been carrying the Music of Primes in English or in Hebrew and have him sign it. It was translated into 10 languages, by the way, which is very, very much for a popular book, for a popular science book. He has won major prizes for his popular work. He has been working with the BBC radio and television. He writes in numerous newspapers in Great Britain. And he has also won, this has impressed me a great deal, he has won some award for presenting Mind Games, a show on BBC TV. On top of that, he plays the trumpet, plays football, and lives in London with his wife, three children, and a cat called Freddie Lundberg. I am tempted to read the first and the last sentences of his abstract. Why did Beckham choose the number 23 shirt? Why indeed? But listen to this. $1 million now awaits the person who can unravel the mystery of the hidden music that might explain the cacophony of the prize. I want to hear this talk.
Did Beckham choose the number 23 shirt? Well, there was a lot of speculation in the British media about why he chose this number 23. Every newspaper had their own different theory. The most popular theory was theory. You see, Real Madrid wanted to sell a lot of football shirts in America. They've never heard of football. They know
about things like basketball and baseball. Who's the most famous basketball player in the world? And it was Michael Jordan, who used to play in the number 23 shirt. So the British newspapers speculated maybe they put a 23 on the back of this football shirt, thinking all these Americans will go and buy it, thinking it's actually a basketball shirt. And then Real Madrid will become even richer than they already are. Others said, no, far too cynical. Actually, maybe a more sinister reason why Beckham has 23 on his back, because anyone who knows their history will know that Julius Caesar was in fact assassinated by being stabbed 23 times in the back. So some said, very bad idea for Beckham to be putting 23 on his back. But being a math nerd, as soon as I saw this number, I said, oh, that's a really interesting number, because it's a prime number. So a prime number is one of these numbers which is only divisible by itself and one. And about the same time as Beckham's move to Real Madrid, I wrote this book all about prime numbers called The Music of the Primes. Now, my publishers in England let me choose all my favourite primes to put on the front cover of my book. So this is the hardback edition. I live at number 53 in London. Of course, I have to live in a prime number house, so that's my front door. I only take prime number buses, so my local bus is the number 73 bus in London. And the local football team that I support is Arsenal Football Club. And we have a rivalry with a team called Tottenham Hotspurs, and we just stolen their best player, Sol Campbell, who plays in defence, and he plays in the number 23 shirt at the time. So to rub it into all my friends who support Spurs, Tottenham Hotspur, I put the number 23 Arsenal shirt on the front cover of my book. Now, a lot of the media saw this book and said, aha, here's the guy who can explain why Beckham chose the number 23 shirt. So I got asked onto various radio stations to explain my theory about the 23 shirt. I don't know, in Israel, do you have a radio station dedicated completely to sport? No? Well, we have this in England, we do. It's called Talk Sport Radio. They just talk sport all the time. And I regard it as one of my greatest coups to get higher mathematics talks on Talk Sport Radio. Anyway, on the way to the studio, I thought, okay, I better think of, you know, what is my explanation for why Beckham chose the 23 shirt? So, well, I started to think, well, why are primes important for me as a mathematician? Well, primes are important because they're literally the building blocks of my subject. If I take a number like 105, you'll know that's not a prime number. It's divisible by 5. Now I get down to 21 times 5. 21 still isn't prime. I can divide that into 3 times 7. But then I've got down to the indivisible numbers. The numbers, these are the prime numbers. I can't divide these anymore. And these are the primes which built that number, 105. So for me, the prime numbers are the building blocks of all numbers. However large a number is, you can keep on doing this, dividing, dividing, until you get down to the indivisible numbers which built that number. So for me, I like to call them the atoms of arithmetic. The chemists, they had this wonderful thing, the periodic table, listing all the atoms from which you can build molecules. Well, for me, the primes 2, 3, 5, they're a little bit like the hydrogen, helium, and lithium of the world of mathematics. They're our building blocks. Well, I started to look at Real Madrid's football team, and it's clear they know this fact that primes are building blocks, because all the key players, the Galacticos at the time, they were all playing in prime number shirts at Real Madrid. They clearly had a mathematician on the bench choosing their shirts. You had Carlos, the building blocks of the defence, number 3. Zidane, building block of the midfield, number 5. Raul, number 7. Ronaldo at the time was playing in the 11 shirt. So Beckham comes along, a building block of their team, a Galacticos. So this mathematician on the bench obviously said, oh, well, he knows the prime number, so let's give him number 23. So that's my theory anyway. And I can talk about prime number football shirts from a little bit of experience, because I also play, as was mentioned in the introduction, a bit of football. And I play for a team in East London we're called Recreativo Hackney. Unfortunately, our squad isn't big enough to have 23 players, so I play in the number 17 shirt for my football team. But unfortunately, we play in the Super Sunday League Division 2. I don't know whether you can find Recreativo here, but unfortunately, our primes didn't do too well for us. We were right down here at the bottom. But don't worry, this is the lowest team, lowest division in London, so the only way was up from here. But my number 17 shirt did help me. If you look at the goals for, we scored 25 goals, and one of those is my goal, which I'm very proud of. But unfortunately, if you look at the goals against, we had a massive 64 goals scored against us, and unfortunately, one of those is also my goal. Which I'm not so proud of. Anyway, I realised that far too many of us were playing in non-prime number shirts, you know, number 10, number 14. So I thought I'd take a little leaf out of Real Madrid's book, and I persuaded my team to change our kit to see if it would have any effect. And we're all playing prime number shirts now. So here's our new kit. We play 2, 3, 5, all the way up to 43, and it transformed our season. We came second in the league. We got promoted to the Super Sunday League Division 1, where we quickly learnt that primes, they only last for one season, because we've been now relegated back down again and we're looking for a new theory. Anyway, Real Madrid, every summer they seem to get bigger and bigger, more and more of these Galacticos, so they're going to need more and more of these prime numbers. So they come along to us, the mathematicians, and say, can we buy a formula off you for finding these prime number shirts for us? And they'll be very surprised to find that we don't have some magic formula to find these primes. In fact, trying to find where the next primes are is one of the biggest mysteries in the whole of mathematics. And I think it goes really to the heart of what it means for me to be a mathematician. When I'm at a party and somebody asks you, so what do you do? I kind of look forward and dread this question slightly, and I say, I'm a mathematician. And you can see their faces drop, and their glasses get very empty, and then they sort of run to the other end of the party. But I'm very persistent, so I run after them and say, no, we're a very misunderstood breed, mathematicians. And I try to explain to them that what I do as a mathematician is I'm a pattern searcher. That's what I like to describe a mathematician as. Somebody's looking for some logic, some order to the sort of chaotic world we live in. And I want to start by introducing you actually to a mathematician from the movies. This is from a film called Pi. Has anyone seen the film Pi? Put your hands up. Oh yeah, we've got some math movie buffs. Excellent. This movie Pi features a mathematician called Max Cohen, who is obsessed with looking for patterns. His particular obsession is looking for patterns in the decimal expansion of pi, which is number 3.14159. That's about as far as I can go. To do with circles. And he's convinced that he's found the secret to the stock exchange hidden inside this decimal expansion. As the movie goes on, he gets madder and madder. It's always the stereotype of the mathematician is that we always go mad by the end of the movie. This is no exception. He starts seeing Kabbalistic messages from God appearing in this expansion. But I do love his obsession for patterns. And he starts every morning of his mantra of what it means for him to be a mathematician. So this is Max Cohen from the film Pi. So we can have the volume up on this. Be great. So here's the decimal expansion. If you spot any patterns, you can shout out. Well, he spotted a pattern there, at least. So, actually, when I tell people I'm a mathematician at parties, I think that's what they think I do all day, that I'm sitting in my office doing long division to lots of decimal places. But I hope to show you we do something slightly more interesting. So.
12:45, we state my assumptions. One, mathematics is the language of nature. Two, everything around us can be represented and understood through numbers. Graph the numbers of any system, patterns emerge. Therefore, there are patterns everywhere in nature.
There are patterns everywhere in nature, and that's somehow the belief of the mathematician is that if something is important, it should have some logic, some structure, some pattern to be able to explain it. But with the primes, as I want to show you, that pattern can be a little bit mysterious and a little bit hidden. And what we're going to do with the primes is to take Max Cohen's advice, and I'm going to graph these numbers a little later on and show you some strange patterns which begin to emerge. I think that search for patterns is perfectly encapsulated in the kind of problems you'll get at school when you're given a sequence of numbers and you have to try and spot the logic, the structure, to work out what the next number is in the sequence. So I've brought a few challenges along to see how good you are at pattern searching here in Jerusalem. Now, obviously the first two are reasonably easy, so if you're studying for a maths degree, you are not allowed to play on those ones. You can look at the third one. But if you're not studying for a maths degree, what's the next number in this sequence? 1, 3, 6, 10, 15, 21, 28. 36, exactly, because you get these by adding 2 to the next number, 3, 4, 5, and we call these the triangular numbers because you can view them very graphically as the number of stones you need to build a triangle where you add an extra layer on each time. Now, we understand these numbers very well. For example, we have a formula which will calculate the 100th triangular number without having to do all the hard work of adding all of the numbers from 1 to 100. Mathematicians love patterns, but we're also very lazy at heart, so we like sort of things which give us shortcuts like formulas. Okay, the second sequence, if you've read the Da Vinci Code, you're also not allowed to play on this one. But if you haven't read the Da Vinci Code, what's the next number in this sequence? 34, exactly. You get this sequence by adding the two previous numbers together. So 13 plus 21 gives you 34. 21 plus 34 gives you 5. And these are some of the most famous numbers in mathematics, called the Fibonacci numbers. Actually, they should be named after an Indian poet who discovered them before Fibonacci. They actually are used, he used them and discovered them by counting rhythms, possible rhythm structures. But they're called the Fibonacci numbers after the Italian mathematician Fibonacci, who discovered these numbers were very important in nature. They're some of nature's favorite numbers. You find them all over the place. So for example, if you count the number of petals on a flower, invariably it's a number in the Fibonacci sequence. And if it isn't, it means that a petal has fallen off your flower, which is how mathematicians get around exceptions. What about the next sequence? If you have got a maths degree, you're allowed to play now. So 2, 9, 10, 11, 13, 16. Yeah, so you saw it flicked to it, yeah. So you've spoiled my joke, which is actually, these are the winning lottery ticket numbers for the 28th of September in England. So, of course, not everything has a pattern. So there's a warning here. Not everything has a pattern. And you have to choose your battles very carefully. So if you're trying to find I wish I had a formula which would produce these numbers. I wouldn't be talking to you now if I did. I would be sitting on a tropical island enjoying myself. But we don't have a formula to produce the lottery ticket numbers. Okay, and the last sequence, of course, are the prime numbers, the numbers at the heart of my talk, which go from 19 to Beckham's number 23, and then have quite a large gap from 23 to 29, 31. And I would say of all the numbers in mathematics, these are probably the most important, because they are our building blocks. They're like our periodic table. So, for example, if we want to, the chemists have been very successful. They've written a whole table down with the atoms from which you can build molecules. So how are the mathematicians doing? Do we have a nice table of primes with all the primes in, or have we spotted some patterns which help us to explain these numbers? And the trouble with these numbers are that if you look at them and try and look for patterns, I've written them as a heartbeat here. So the heart beats every time I run over a prime number, and it's incredibly difficult to predict when the next beat is going to occur. We get to 17, 19, then a little gap, 23, then a big gap as the subject died. No, it's 29, 31, then another big gap, 37, then a double beat at 41 and 43. And as you climb higher and higher, it seems incredibly difficult to be able to say when the heart is going to beat next. In fact, mathematicians feel there's much more in common between the national lottery ticket numbers and the primes than between the primes and the Fibonacci and triangular numbers. When you look at the primes as they're laid out, they seem to be as random as if they were chosen by some lottery. So this is the real challenge. How can we understand some structure to these numbers? These numbers build the subject, the science of patterns, yet they seem to have no structure in them at all. So how do we understand them? Well, who are the first people to really get to grips with these numbers? Well, it wasn't mathematicians at all, actually, but a curious little insect which lives in the forest in North America. This insect has a very curious life cycle. It's a cicada. You only find them in North America, these special ones. And the cicada hides underground doing absolutely nothing for 17 years. Then after 17 years, these cicadas emerge en masse. They seem to know on which day to appear. They all appear at the same time. And they sing away. Here's the sound of one cicada. You have to multiply these by about 100,000 of these things. The sound of the forest is so loud that residents move out of the area. It's unbearable. Then the cicadas sort of eat the trees, they mate, they lay eggs. And then after 6 weeks of partying, the forest goes quiet again. They all die. And there's another 17 years of peace before the next generation appears. So what is it about 17 that the cicada likes? Is it just a coincidence? It's a prime number. Well, it seems not. There's also another species which hides underground for 7 years, and another species in another area in America which hides underground for 13 years. So 7, 13, 17, all prime numbers. So what is it about the primes which seem to be helping these cicadas? But we're not really too sure. But the best theory you have to date is that we think there might have been a predator that also used to appear periodically in the forest. And the predator used to try and time its arrival to coincide with the cicada. And the cicadas found that those which had a prime number life cycle could keep out of sync much better from the predator than those with a non-prime number life cycle. So, for example, if the predator appears every 6 years, then a cicada that appears every 9 years is going to meet it in year 18. A cicada that appears every 8 years is going to meet it in year 24. But the cicada, which appears every 7 years, appearing more often, won't meet it until year 42. So it seems like there was a real competition in this forest to find primes. The cicada got up to 17. The predator was not unable to find the prime that the cicada had found, and it seems like the predator died out, and the cicada has been left with this prime number life cycle. Intriguingly, we had a beautiful piece of piano music earlier on. Another piece of piano music, part of the Quartet for the End of Time by Messiaen, also uses this idea of primes to keep things out of sync, to give a sense of timelessness in the Quartet for the End of Time. Messiaen, in the piano piece of this quartet, has a rhythm structure which is 17 notes in length and a harmonic structure which is 29 notes in length. And as the piece is played, they interlock in different ways all the way through the piece, and actually you never hear them repeat because the piece is ended by then. So you can find this sort of the use of primes not only in nature but also in that piece of music. So the cicadas were the first to find the primes, but of course it's the ancient Greeks that we generally credit with the first great discoveries about prime numbers. And in particular, one of my the sort of greatest theorems, I think, in mathematics, a beautiful proof of the fact that, you know, if you wanted to write the primes down in some large table, perhaps you want to produce a periodic table of primes, then anyone who tried to write down the primes in a large table would be writing forever, because Euclid proved that the primes, there are infinitely many of these numbers. They go on forever. There's no way you can write them all down. And it's a beautiful little argument, a proof that Euclid gave to show why anyone who tried to write down the primes and said, okay, these are all the primes. Suppose, for example, in my football team, you might say, okay, we've got all the primes, 2, 3, 5, all the way up to 43, there are no more. So here, I'm going to get my football team to help explain why there always will be another football shirt after 43. However big our team gets, we'll always be able to find another prime number shirt.
I want to show that it's in the numbers in my football team, 2 up to 43. Suppose those are all the prime numbers there are. Perhaps we can build all other numbers by multiplying the primes in our football team together. Euclid came up with this clever way to show why there must be a number which can't be built out of those primes from 2 to 43. What he did was to take all our football shirts, multiply them together. So we did 2 times 3 times 5 times 7, all the way up to 43. Then it was his act of genius. What he did was to add 1 to the number. Now, can this new number that you could build be built out of any of the primes in our football team? Well, no, because if you divide that number of Euclid's by any of the numbers in our football team, you always get a remainder 1. And so Euclid's found a number which isn't built out of any of the primes in our football team. So there must be another football shirt with a different prime number which is helping you to build that number that Euclid's built.
That was part of a video we made, which you can find on YouTube, actually. It's a 5-minute video about what I would like to teach the world. So this is my choice, to teach the world the proof of there being infinitely many primes. And I think it is such a beautiful argument. If any of you came and said, look, I've got all the primes written down in a table, what Euclid says is, multiply those primes together, add 1 to that number, and then tell me, which primes divide this number? It's none of the ones on your list, because you all always get remainder 1. So you've missed some primes that divide this number. Well, you could say, well, just add those 9 primes now to the table. Well, he can keep on playing the same trick and show you're always missing some primes. So it's a beautiful argument. But the trouble is that it doesn't give you a way of finding the primes. You might say, okay, great, if I had 2, 3, and 5, multiply those together, I get 30, plus 1, 31, I've got a new prime number. But unfortunately, it doesn't always give you a new prime number. So for example, if you multiply 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, and then add 1 to that, well, that's not divisible by any of the primes 2 up to 13, but it's not a new prime number. It's divisible by some primes missing from 2 up to 13, but it's not a new prime number. So although Euclid has found a way to show that the primes must go on forever, he's not found a way to find them. In fact, to show you how little we understand about these numbers, this is the largest prime number we've so far discovered. I mean, it's a fairly big one. It's got nearly 13 million digits, If I was going to read it out aloud to you, it would probably take me about 2 months to do it, which I'm not going to, you'll be pleased to hear. It was the first prime actually to pass the 10 million digit mark, and Ernst, the person who found it, a prize which was shared with the people who devised the program of $100,000. In fact, there's another prize next for the one which beats the 100 million digit mark, but that will take some time. But it shows, you know, if you ask me to find a 100 million digit triangular number or Fibonacci number, I'd have no trouble doing that. But to find a prime with such big number of digits, we really don't know how to do it. And it's really, I think, illustrates how little we understand about these numbers. But we have begun to make progress, and we have found some rather hidden patterns inside these numbers. And I think what makes a great mathematician is somebody who can do lateral thinking. And I rather like this quote from Enrico Bombieri, who's an expert in prime numbers in Princeton. He wrote, "When things get too complicated, it sometimes makes sense to stop and wonder, have I asked the right question? And maybe with the primes, we were just asking the wrong question. We were after a formula which would help us to find these primes. We were looking to find some sort of, you know, some reason to where the next prime will be after the one we know now. And maybe we need to ask something different about the primes to be able to find a pattern." And it was one of the most famous mathematicians in the whole history of our subject, Carl Friedrich Gauss, who changed the question, asked something new about the primes, and discovered a hidden pattern inside these numbers. Now, Gauss was clearly going to be a great mathematician from the word go. Already by the age of 3, he was correcting his father's arithmetic when he was handing out wages at the end of the week. And by the age of 15, the sort of thing he wanted for his birthday was a book of mathematical tables, kind of thing we like to get for our birthdays. So this was, at 15, he got given this book of logarithm tables. Now, I just want to check, see the level of the audience. Could you put your hand up if you know what a logarithm is, please? Okay, that's pretty good. Keep your hand up if you've used a set of logarithm tables. Yeah, it's all the old people in the room now. I shall also put my hand up. So logarithms, if you don't know what a logarithm is, this is all you need to know about them. What they do is to change multiplication into addition. And they were very powerful because multiplying two large numbers can take you some time, but adding large numbers together is very easy. So these logarithm tables were used as a sort of form of calculator. It's what engineers would have to use, merchants, navigators. They would change multiplication into addition. So that's all you need to know to understand the discovery that Gauss made. Now, Gauss wasn't particularly interested in the logarithms in the front of the book. What began to fascinate him was at the back of the book, there was a table of prime numbers. And this began to obsess the young Gauss. And he started adding more and more primes to this list. Instead of going out on the town in Göttingen overnight, he would stay in and add more and more primes to this table. And these primes began to obsess him. And by asking a new question about these primes, he managed to find some pattern in there. And amazingly, he managed to find a connection between the primes at the back of the book and the logarithms at the front of this book. It's kind of spooky that he got given this book with the two things together, and by asking a new question, he found a connection between them. So what was the new question that Gauss asked? He said, okay, I'm not going to look for a formula to find these primes. I'm not going to try and find a reason to find the next prime. I'm going to count how many primes there are. So you might say this is a very silly thing to do because Euclid and my football team have already shown you there are infinitely many primes, so how can you count them? Well, Gauss said, no, I want to know how many primes are there, say, in the first 10 numbers. Okay, well, there are 4, 2, 3, 5, and 7. Actually, there were 5 at the time when Gauss was looking for primes because 1 used to be included as a prime number. It was 1 was at the front of that table. But now, because we've changed our mind about primes are building blocks and 1 doesn't really build anything new. If you multiply by 1, you get nothing new. At school, we tell our kids it's because it has have to have exactly 2 divisors. But that's the wrong reason. It's about the fact that you don't build anything new with 1. So we'll count them in the modern way. 2, 3, 5, and 7. 4 primes less than 10. How about up to 100? How many times did that heartbeat beat all the way up to 100? Well, it beat 25 times. There are 25 primes up to 100. So this is what Gauss is going to try and do. Understand whether we can understand a pattern to the number of primes as you count higher and higher. And he's liked to view things quite graphically. So here's a graph. This graph counts the number of primes. I like to call it the staircase of the primes. So every time you run over a new prime number, the graph takes a step upwards. So for example, 101 is a new prime, so when it runs over 101, the height of the graph steps up from 25 to 26. So inside this graph is everything you want to know about the primes. The minutiae of this graph tells you exactly where the primes are. You understand this graph, you understand the primes. Okay, well, here's some data to show you the pattern that Gauss found. And the pattern is going to emerge in this last column here. This is much more data than Gauss had available to him, but it will help us to explain the pattern that Gauss discovered. What does this last column record? Well, here are the primes. Up to 100, we saw that there are 25 primes. The last column records the proportion of primes to all numbers. One in four numbers up to 100 is a prime number. 25 out of 100, 1 in 4. So that's what this last column records. It says that 1 in 4 numbers up to 100 is a prime. What about up to 1,000? Well, there are 168 primes up to 1,000. Don't worry about the middle column. How many primes are there amongst all numbers now? 1 in 6. They're starting to get rarer. 1 in 6 numbers up to 1,000 is a prime number. So, for example, I live in London, and my London telephone number is about 8 digits. So here's the number of primes less than a digit. So what's the probability that my telephone number is a prime number? Well, it says, this last column tells you there's a 1 in 15 chance that my number is prime. And it's kind of a nerdy thing we mathematicians do. Whenever I get a telephone number, I always check to see whether it was a prime number. And in fact, I had to move house a couple of years ago, and I had to get a new telephone number. And I phoned the woman up at our telephone company in England, and she gave me this number. I quickly ran it through my little computer to see whether it was prime, and it wasn't a prime. So I thought, oh, I'm never going to remember that. Could you give me another one? So she gave me another number. I quickly ran it through, and it still wasn't prime. So we did this a few times, at which point she said, look, I'm just giving you the next number that comes out. You can't have another number. And so now, unfortunately, I have an even telephone number of all things. So very miserable. But I probably had to have about 15 numbers for one of them to have been prime. So that's the probability. So I want you all to go home and prove that you're real mathematicians and check whether your telephone number is prime. And then this last column will tell you what the proportion of you should have a prime number telephone number. OK, so it's in this last column that Gauss discovered a pattern. And you can think of this last column, and Gauss was after some sort of model of how to generate the primes. And if you think the primes look very random, a good model might be that nature chose them in some sort of random manner. So maybe nature had a sort of set of prime number dice. And so around 1,000, you see there's a 1 in 6 chance that a number is prime. So maybe you had a cube with P written on one face and all of the other five faces blank, and nature somehow tossed a dice to see whether, okay, is 1,000 the prime? Let's toss the dice. Oh, it landed on the P side. Let's say 1,000 is a prime. Now, clearly 1,000 isn't prime, but it was a model that Gauss was after, a heuristic model of how the primes might be generated. So another way to interpret this last column, it's the number of sides on the prime number dice as you climb higher and higher through the universe of numbers. And it's here that Gauss spotted a pattern. The pattern emerges around here, about 10,000. So now there are 8.1 sides on this prime number dice. Now, these are very mathematical dice, which have 8.1 sides. I'm happy with that. Now, multiply the first column by 10. So 10,000 goes up to 100,000. The number of sides on the dice goes up by adding 2.3. Multiply again by 10, 100,000 to 1,000,000. The number of sides on the dice again goes up by adding 2.3. Every time you multiply the first column by 10, the number of sides on the dice seems to go up in this incredibly uniform manner, but just by adding 2.3. Now, there's a little 2.4 here, but that's because I've sort of rounded things up. And it seems to be a very strong pattern emerging here, which Gauss thought must go on forever. So he believed if you multiply by 10, then you need to add 2.3 to the number of sides on the dice, the way the primes get rarer and rarer. And here is the connection with the logarithm. The logarithm turns its multiplication into addition. So in fact, the logarithm function is the function which tells you the number of sides on that prime number dice. It tells you what the probability is that a number will be prime. So for example, if I want to know whether a number at random, 1,000,000, what's the probability that it's a prime number? Well, Gauss was guessing that it'd be a 1 in a logarithm of 1,000,000 chance that that number will be prime. These are logarithms, if you know what I'm going to say next, to the natural base rather than to base 10. But essentially, this logarithm function enables you to to make a guess at what the probability of the primes are, and it shows you how they're thinning out. Now, Gauss made this guess. He didn't know whether it would be lasting forever. Perhaps it's just a trick of the very small numbers. But 100 years later, in 1896, it was proved that the primes do thin out in this very uniform way. Now, this is absolutely amazing. This is a 15-year-old boy discovered this pattern in the primes. 15-year-old boy. And you can use this probability to estimate how many primes you'll get. If I throw a prime number dice with six faces 30 times, it will land on the prime side 5 times. So I can guess that the primes, number of primes between 1,000 and 1,029, I should get about 5 primes. So this enables you, this pattern, to estimate how many primes there'll be as you climb higher and higher. And so you just add up the probabilities. Now here's Gauss's guess, actually made at a later age. This is something called the logarithmic integral, which he smoothed out a little bit. And you can see it's a pretty good estimate for the way this graph is growing. It seems that early on to always overestimate slightly, and indeed, if you look at the primes between 1,000 and 1,029, there are actually only 4 primes up to in that region. But Gauss believed that that this would be a very good estimate, and would get sort of relatively closer and closer. But he couldn't prove it, and it was proved 100 years later that indeed this is a good estimate. Now, this is good enough for an engineer, this kind of estimate, but for mathematicians, we like things to be precise. It's not a precise formula yet. It's got a little bit of error either side of it. And what we would love is a precise formula for this staircase counting the number of primes. And it wasn't Gauss, but Gauss's student, Riemann, who discovered how to correct Gauss's guess and get an exact formula for the number of primes. And this is where the music hiding behind the primes suddenly appears. Because in order to be able to correct that graph, to change the graph that Gauss has got, which is a good estimate, into the real graph which counts the primes, we need to add something onto it. And it's the same explanation as how to capture music using things called sine waves or tuning forks. So here's Bernhard Riemann. Bernhard Riemann essentially discovered the same sort of mathematics which goes into how your iPod records a piece of music. Your iPod essentially breaks down a piece of music into basic building blocks of sound. And these basic building blocks, discovered by Fourier, are the sound of a tuning fork. So that's why we use a tuning fork to tune things. It's somehow the purest sound. And if you graph it on an oscilloscope, what you get is this perfect sine wave. And Fourier discovered that any graph, basically, can be built out of combining sine waves of different frequencies. So, for example, here's a violin. Violin has a very different, when it plays an A, it doesn't sound like a tuning fork. It's a very sharp sound. And that's because it's not just playing the A of the tuning fork, it's playing a lot of other notes as well, called the harmonics. If you record the sound of a violin on an oscilloscope, it's a very sharp sort of sound. And it's playing lots of notes, not just the A of the tuning fork. It, in fact, plays every sine wave that you can fit between the bridge and the top of the violin. So here's the sort of A that you're hearing, which is the basic sine wave which can fit. But you can fit a sine wave which vibrates twice as fast and half the wavelength. This produces a note which is an octave higher. It has other sine waves it can fit. Here's the sixth harmonic, vibrates 7 times as fast. And it's the combination of all of these notes together which makes the characteristic sound of the violin. That's how somebody records in an iPod, for example, makes a violin by making the loudspeaker vibrate with all of these different frequencies. So let's see a graphical version of this. Here's the sine wave of the tuning fork. Now, to make it turn into a violin, what I need to do is to add on of these other harmonics. So we had another graph, we went up and down, so the sine wave there. Well, if we add that graph on, this bit pushes this bit of the graph up. But the lower part is negative, so it pulls this bit back down. So adding on all of the harmonics, all the notes the violin is playing, the tuning fork gets changed into this sharp sound of the violin. So you can change the sort of first approximation is the tuning fork, this sine wave, add on all of the other harmonics, and you get the sound of the violin. Each different instrument has its own different harmonics. The clarinet, for example, the oscilloscope records a very sort of like the crenellations on a castle, a very square sound. You can almost hear it in the clarinet, very sort of closed sort of sound. Why does it have this different shape? Because there are different sine waves which fit in the length of the clarinet. So the clarinet has to be open at one end. It's not a string, it's open. So this is the A, this is the first sine wave you fit here. But the second sine wave that fits is actually three times the frequency. Clarinets like sort of odd numbers, whilst the violin likes all numbers. So you get a different set of harmonics, and you add these onto the tuning forks, and now look what happens. I'm not going to add the same harmonic as the violin. This one vibrates three times as fast, so it dips negatively in the middle. So it's going to pull the bottom, the middle bit of the graph down and push the sides up. So when we add on the harmonics of the clarinet, instead of getting a sharp shape, we get this sort of square shape happening because of the different frequencies of the sine waves which fit in the clarinet. So here, the violin, you see, likes all numbers, whilst the clarinet, it only likes sort of odd numbers. So why is this the key to the primes? Well, what Riemann discovered is that the primes also have harmonics which help to change Gauss's graph into the graph which counts the primes. So just in the same way as I've changed the clarinets from a sine wave into a square shape, what Riemann discovered is that Gauss's guess should be considered a little bit like the sine wave, the first approximation to all of these instruments. But then, if you want the subtleties of the primes, what you need to add on are these strange harmonics that Riemann discovered. He discovered them by combining some fantastic bits of mathematics, complex numbers, imaginary numbers, with something called the zeta function, and the zeros of the zeta function are what gave him these notes. So essentially, there are sort of variations on sine waves, but they're the harmonics which help you to change Gauss's guess into the real staircase of the primes. So there are infinitely many of these harmonics. Now, this is the graph I want to show you. This graph, this little animation I'm going to show you, represents Riemann's discovery, Riemann's equation for the primes. I must warn you that those who haven't got maths degrees, I am pushing you into mathematics, which we don't usually show our undergraduates, let alone our graduates. The graduates will start to see this. But this is my favorite equation in the whole of mathematics. If I was cast out on a desert island and I had to take one equation with me, I would take this equation, which is why I wanted to show it to you. So what is this equation? It's Riemann says, if you want to count how many primes there are, that is equal to Gauss's guess using the logarithm and the dice, plus all of these sine waves, these harmonics that Riemann discovered. So at the moment, what I've got here is the staircase of the primes. That's the blue staircase. And then I've got the yellow, the yellow line here, which is a slight variation on Gauss's guess. And now what I'm going to do is to add on the harmonics that Riemann discovered. So they're sort of going up and down like this. And I'm going to add them on to the yellow graph here. And as we add on more and more of these harmonics, essentially contained inside these harmonics are the errors that these dice are making. Okay, the theoretical dice says there should be five primes between 1,000 and 1,029. But there are only four. There's a little bit of error because randomness has errors in it. These sine waves have encoded inside them the way the dice really landed. So let's add on all of these harmonics. And gradually what happens is these harmonics push and pull the graph. They say you've overestimated, so pull a bit down. You've underestimated, so add a little bit more on. Just in the same way as the graph of the clarinet emerged from the sine waves being added together onto the tuning fork, what happens here, after 100 of these harmonics, of Riemann's harmonics, Gauss's guess has been pushed and pulled until we have a pretty good estimate for where the primes are landing. In fact, now, you could never have known there are no primes between 23 and 29 using Gauss's guess, but Riemann's harmonics tells you that indeed there are no primes between 23 and 29. So these harmonics are a way of understanding the way the primes are laid out. They're inside here are encoded the distribution of the primes. Now Riemann realized, just in the same way, if I'm translating a piece of music into these sine waves and putting it on an iPod, there are two important pieces of information. What is the frequency of the sine wave? And how loud do you want it played? How important is it to the music? So the amplitude of the wave is another important factor. So Riemann said, let's plot these notes which help us to explain the distribution of the prime. And he plot a graph which has on one side the frequency and on the other side how loud the notes are being played. So the frequency is up on the vertical. The horizontal records how big the waves are. Now, at first sight, these notes could have been scattered all over the place, and I think probably Riemann was expecting that, but when he calculated the location of 10 of these notes describing how the primes are laid out, they weren't randomly distributed at all. In fact, they all seem to be lining up on this straight line, something we now call the critical line, Riemann's critical line. And this line seemed to be saying that all of these notes were playing at about the same volume. None were dominating any of the others. They all seemed to be playing in this perfect sort of balance. Now, Riemann couldn't believe it's just a coincidence that the first 10 were lying on this straight line. And he made a conjecture, a hypothesis. He said, I think all of these notes are going to be lying on this line. I think the amplitude of all of these notes is going to be about the same. And that's now called the Riemann hypothesis. It's our greatest unsolved problem. And it would explain in some ways why the primes are looking so random. Bombieri has a nice description. He said, if the Riemann hypothesis is false, that means one of those notes is off that line. It means it's playing much louder than any of the others. He says it'd be like listening to an orchestra, and suddenly it's a beautiful orchestra playing away, and then suddenly the tuba comes in and blasts out all the rest of the music, and all you can hear is this one note of the tuba. And he didn't believe that would be happening. So for Bombieri and for Riemann and for mathematicians, the fact that all of these primes seem to be playing at the same level seems to be saying there's no strong pattern in these numbers. That tuba would be like forcing a strong pattern on the primes. And so if the zeros of the notes are lined up on this line, it might explain why we're seeing no strong patterns. There are no notes playing any louder than any others. Here's another way to view what the Riemann hypothesis is saying. The primes are a little bit like molecules of gas in this room. I don't know the precise location of each of the molecules of gas. And actually, I don't need to do a lot of good physics. But what I do know is that if I go into the corner of the lecture room here, I'm not going to suddenly find a vacuum where I can't breathe. I know that the primes, the molecule is going to be sort of fairly but randomly distributed about this room. The Riemann hypothesis was explained, would predict the same thing about primes. It will say, it won't help you to find exactly where the primes are, but it will help you to say that they seem to be fairly distributed through the universe of numbers. And very often for mathematicians, that's enough for us to be able to make progress. I have several theorems which say, suppose the primes are laid out like they are. That means I know that I'm not going to have large stretches of numbers where I'm not going to find any primes. But this has still not been proved. It's still a hypothesis. Here's another nice way to interpret the Riemann hypothesis. It actually implies that the dice that nature seems to be using to choose the primes are actually a fair set of dice. That they're not sort of biased and forcing the primes to be in one place and not another. But still, for 150 years, in fact, we're celebrating, many people are celebrating 150 years of Darwin and the Origin of Species being published. But I'm not celebrating that at all. This year, I am celebrating 150 years of Riemann writing the paper where he believed that these notes would all be on this line, published the same month as Darwin's book in November. And for 150 years, we've been trying to prove that this theorem is true, but we haven't been able to do it. And now, as the last sentence of the synopsis said, there's, in fact, a prize of $1 billion for the first person who can prove that these notes really do line up on this line. And I think in some ways it's the structure there. Then Riemann changes them into something else again, into music, where suddenly when you plot this music, there seems to be an incredibly strong pattern appearing. And it's this pattern in the music which we think will help to explain how the primes are distributed. And if you want to find out a little bit more about how much we've understood about this music, how it seems to be connected now with things like quantum physics, how these primes are even involved now in cryptography on the internet, then this book in Hebrew will help you win your $1 million. So thank you very much. Yeah, can I take questions?
Well, thank you very much for this amazing talk. With Professor Dussatoy's permission, we'll keep on celebrating Darwin's publishing of this Origin of Species, but I do think that we shall start celebrating you too.
That's all right. I'll take that compromise. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Any questions? Not a lot, I assume, but...
Once there's one, there's always many. So you just have to be confident to ask the first one, and then. Okay, so there's a question over. Why did Beckham choose the number 23? To tell you the truth, it was probably. You'd be surprised that Beckham actually does know something about mathematics. I discovered on Real Madrid TV that he presents a program called David Beckham Explains Maths. How
Yeah, he rather blew my theory, because when he played in Italy last season, he actually chose the number 32. Right, maybe it's just...
But I suppose 32 is a power of a prime, so maybe, you know, he was going for that rather than... there are probably many reasons, but mathematics may not be one of them. He has tattooed on his arm, actually, the number 7, which is the number he played for in Man United. And I do think he could change it. It's in Roman numerals. So he's able to change that. He can put it, the V into an X, add another X, and put another 1, and he'll have 23. So maybe, I don't know.
Any other questions?
Yeah, there's a question here.
If Gauss's guess was lower than the actual logarithm, so why has it chosen the base of 2.3 instead of the base of e? Approximately.
Oh, well, it is a base of e. I mean, I just sort of approximated. 2.3 is logarithm base e of 10. That's why you're getting the adding of 2.3. But let me say something about this overestimating, because it's very interesting. Gauss thought that his estimate would always overestimate. It's about the one thing Gauss got wrong in his life. Most of his intuitions were right. But it's incredibly, a computer would never have discovered this point. This is why mathematics is better than a computer. His guess continually, infinitely often, overestimates, then underestimates, then overestimates, then underestimates. But the first region where it underestimates is well beyond anything that computationally you would have discovered. This seems to play a little sort of dance between the two. Yeah, there's a question. There you go. I told you once you have one.
Great. There were any discoveries in mathematics in order to prove.
The primes. And this says that if you look at the frequencies of Riemann's notes, which is how they're laid out on that line, we believe they are all on that line, they seem to share a lot in common, the way they're distributed on that line, with energy levels in the nucleus of large atoms like uranium. Now, this seems to be very strange. Why should there be any connection between these harmonics explaining the distribution of primes and energy levels in a large atom like uranium? But what it seems to be telling us is a sort of message that the sort of mathematics which we use to understand quantum physics will be the right sort of mathematics which will also help us to explain the way the primes are distributed. And a lot of work is going into, at the moment, trying to understand whether that connection really might give us a way to generate that music. And it's certainly, the physicists have been telling us things using their model that we couldn't predict from a mathematical point of view about the primes. So it seems to be a really nice dialogue which is going on at the moment between physics and mathematics. Yeah, the person here has got a mic. Yeah.
So going back to Gauss's conjecture, when you showed us the conjecture, you had a table with a lot of data. So you had the number of primes up to 1 million, 10 million, 1 million. I guess Gauss had a lot less data than that. So how could he make a conjecture based on so little data?
It's quite phenomenal, actually. But he already, what he would do was to take, I think, them in batches of about 1,000. And already in batches of 1,000 around, I think he got up to, let me just take it back and see whether I can remember where he, could you take the lights down, thanks. If I remember, that he had things around 1 million. And so what he would do, that he would take it in batches of 1,000 and sees by sort of taking this step backwards, there did seem to be some uniform way to the number. So I think that what he did, I mean, there was already some hint, it should be said, that the logarithm was something to do with the primes. Euler had already found some sort of connection between the primes and the logarithm function. So that might have given, if Gauss knew that, but I'm not sure he would have seen that as a 15-year-old. I don't think he would have known about that. But by taking batches of 1,000 around there, he could see that the numbers seemed to be roughly the same. And so but then, you know, if he moves from 10,000, he saw that the number is changing when you go from, say, 10,000, 100,000 to 1 million. But yeah, I don't think he was getting beyond 10 million. I think a million, but... Lights up. There's a question here.
Could you elaborate what are
What are the harmonics of the prime numbers? I kind of made this like mysterious thing suddenly appeared, which helped you to explain these things. And indeed, it should be said that when you read Riemann's paper, the way that these sort of harmonics appear is quite mysterious. And essentially, what is going on is that these harmonics come from something called the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. The zeta function is a function which encodes prime numbers in the way that it is defined. Okay, it's a function which, if you want to know its details, essentially, it's related actually to harmonics. So if you add 1 plus a half plus a third plus a quarter plus a fifth plus a sixth all the way up to infinity, that actually adds up. So those are like the harmonics of the violin. That adds up to infinity. But if you square each of those numbers, 1 plus a half squared plus a third squared plus a quarter squared plus a fifth squared, then this actually converges to a number pi squared over 6. And so what Riemann was interested in was taking the powers of the harmonic series as a function. So he would say, okay, well, I put the number 2 in, square everything, or put number 3 in and cube everything. So this function, actually, to build it, you can build it using prime numbers, because every number in those harmonics can be pulled apart into primes. So this function, in one sense, is built by primes. But what Riemann did was he said, okay, I want to mix this up with something called complex numbers, imaginary numbers. And when he fed those into this function, he realized that also this function could be defined by all the places where this function outputs zero. And those are called the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. And these two things, essentially different sides of the same equation. That primes help you to build the Riemann zeta function, and zeros also help you to define the zeta function. So what Riemann has said is there must be some connection between these two. And the connection that he got when he followed through the mathematics is to get a formula which can be interpreted in this musical way, that if you want to get the primes, what you do is say the logarithm function plus all of the harmonics
generated by the location of these zeros.
So I tried to shortcut all of the mathematics by going straight for what Riemann's discovery was, is essentially ways to correct Gauss's guess. And that's what these harmonics are.
One question.
What would be the largest impact for mathematics if the Riemann hypothesis would be proven?
Well, the two theorems that I proved will be true, because they say, suppose the Riemann hypothesis is true. But no, I mean, there are literally thousands of theorems which are depending on us knowing how the primes are distributed. So once it gets proved, all of these people would breathe a sigh of relief and know that their theorems are correct. But of course, I think the important thing is that when you make a mathematical discovery, it often tells you much more than you were expecting to. So for example, Fermat's last theorem, the fact that this equation doesn't have any non-trivial solutions has not had a major impact on the subject. But the proof has. The discoveries that we've made on the journey to be able to prove that equation has no solutions has had a major impact on mathematics. So I would expect that the same thing will be happening with the primes, that our discovery of why those notes are lying up on that line will tell us so much more about the primes. So, ultimately, that might help you, for example, to understand the cryptography that's used at the moment on the internet, which uses prime numbers in order to keep the thing secure. Essentially, it's the fact that we don't know enough about the primes is why this security works. I would say that probably the proof of the Riemann hypothesis will not give you enough information to be able to crack codes on the internet, but you never know. Another rather cute thing, Gauss, it would imply, I think, Gauss is quite interested if you do, if you do 1 divided by 7 and expand it as a decimal, it has 6 numbers which repeat itself. And that's the maximum that could repeat. So I think 1 over 19, for example, has 18 digits which repeat itself. So a cute little implication of this would be, I think, that there are infinitely many primes which, when you do 1 divided by that prime, it's the maximal number of digits that you have to do before the thing repeats itself as a fraction. But, you know, that excites me. It may not excite you. Who's got a mic next? Oh, yeah, there we go, in the middle. This guy also needs a mic because he's been putting his hand up for
He said that the primes are not above computational numbers. So if you have a number that you can't compute, how do you say it's prime? How do you divide it with numbers you can't compute?
Say the question again.
If you have a really big number that you can't compute, how do you say
that it's divisible by primes? Okay, yeah, well, that's a good example, you know, of the power of mathematics, that we what you do is suppose there is a number which cannot be broken up, divided into primes. And let's take the smallest one of those, okay? Well, it's not prime, because either it's prime or it can be divided. But now, if it's not prime, it's divisible by two things, yeah? Those two things are smaller, and we know those two smaller numbers, because the number we chose was the smallest one that couldn't be written as a product of primes. But we've just divided it into two smaller numbers which can be written as products of primes. So that means there cannot be a number which cannot be written as a product of primes or primes itself. So again, I think this is the power of mathematics. I'm able to say, prove something about infinitely many numbers using this bit of logical reasoning, whilst a computer could never do that. It might take one number after another, but so computationally I could never prove that each number can be written as a product of primes. But theoretically, I'm able to give you an argument why, well, if there isn't a number which can be written as primes multiplied together, take the smallest one of those, and that's either prime or can be written as two smaller numbers multiplied together, but now those two smaller numbers must be written as products of primes because it's smaller than the smallest one. I think that's the power of mathematics. I find it amazing that our finite brains can conceive of the infinite. I think that's what turned me on to be a mathematician. Now you get your chance.
Is there a real connection between the fact that a scale of note is completed by 8 notes and the atom level is also being completed by over 8
atoms? No, I would say that's a false connection, because partly, if you're going to look for a connection, 8 notes is a particular scale. I would say 12 is the most important number, because harmony gives you 12 semitone differences between the octave. And why is that? It's a cute bit of mathematics explaining that. It's, it isn't quite right. The thing about musical harmony is that it's not an exact science. So the reason that we have... let me try and see whether this is right. That 3 to the power 12 is about 2 to the power 19. It's very, very close. And that's the reason when you take cycles of fifths, which the Pythagoras discovered, you know, the fifth is a very beautiful note, and then he kept on taking more and more fifths. And if you do that 12 times, you almost hit the octave, but there's a little bit of difference. So I say it's 12 is the important number, but again, it's not exactly right. And, you know, that's European culture. If you go to Indonesia, they say, don't stop there, let's go to 53. The gamelan will be 53 times repeating that, and you get a little bit closer. It's beautiful. It's actually the difference between why the square root of 2 cannot be written as a fraction, and it's that little difference is what is the problem with harmony. So I'd say it was not, that's a false connection.
We'll have 2 more questions.
Yeah, then I've got to go to a wedding in Herzliya, so. Oh, yeah, great, yeah.
You mentioned a few links forged in the search right now between physics and potential discoveries, but have there been any discoveries we've made on the way thus far?
Specifically with the physics connection? In general, well, I think there are lots of things we've discovered about primes. I think this one that was proved quite recently is rather nice. If you take the prime 5 and you add 6 to that number, you get 11. That's another prime. Add 6 to that, you get 17. It's another prime. Add 6 to that, you get 23. Another prime. Add 6 to that, you get 29. Another prime. And then it breaks down, okay? But I've got... that's quite a long sort of sequence of primes, one after the other. And so the question is, can you find arbitrarily long sequences like that, where you take a prime, add something to it, and I can get, I think maybe, did I get 5 in a row there or something? Can I get like 100 by taking a prime, adding something, the same thing? And that was proved just recently, that, yeah, indeed, you can always find, you know, as long a sequence as you want like that. I mean, it doesn't help you to find where it is, but in fact, and that's one, the person who discovered it, one of the people who discovered it, one of the Fields Medals in the last round of prizes.
Last question, please.
Yes. The 2.3 special number is also actually for the biggest prime number you brought today?
Well, no, there's not a...
To 42 million.
So what's the question, sorry?
The question is if the 2.3 number...
Yeah.
Yeah. If you make an extrapolation,
yeah,
you get the same difference?
Well, the 2.3 is about looking at primes by taking a step backwards. It's about looking at the overall arching pattern of the primes. That very large prime I gave you is like looking at one particular prime. And so there is, I wouldn't say there's a connection between those two. But there is there's an interesting connection with the 2.3, actually, which is that prime is a very special sort of prime. It's called a Mersenne prime. It's 2 to the power of something minus 1. Actually, if you want to, Mersenne was very involved in musical harmony as well, actually, and you can think of that almost like a discordant note, because when you double a note, you get the octave, so you double it many times, and then you take one off it and hope that it suddenly becomes discordant. But how are those prime? That's, I think, about the 47th Mersenne prime. We actually, how are they, those special primes, how are they? How rare are they? We think that primes behave like the logarithm. These Mersenne primes will be so rare that they behave like the logarithm of the logarithm. So there is a sort of 2.3 can help you to predict how rare those sort of primes are. But
thank you very much.
Pleasure.